In my previous video, I showed the conversion of my CPU to VHDL. This time, I'll show the usage of Evolution to convert my CPU to Verilog. So as not to be redundant and bore viewers who have seen my VHDL video, I'll skip some of the introductory stuff and circuit prep. Please refer to my VHDL video if you need to. As stated in my previous video, the reason to do the conversion is that in order to put your design into a field-programmable gate array, or FPGA, you need to code it in a language such as VHDL or Verilog. Once it's in an FPGA, you can use your design in the real world, so to speak. Before I show the conversion, I'll show a new feature of my design. I created an assembly instruction TTY jar library. It's connected to the instruction register and shows the instruction currently being executed by interpreting the IR value. It shows the Z register value in hexadecimal, decimal, and ASCII character if applicable. I decided to do things differently in this video, so it won't be boring for those who saw my VHDL video. This time, I'll fix as much as possible in the circuit before creating the code, rather than fixing it in the code. And later, I'll use a different program for editing and another version of Evolution, and Altera's Quartus Prime IDE. So be sure to watch all of this video. Evolution's 32-bit ROM bug that I pointed out in my previous video only affects the VHDL code, not Verilog. There is, however, another 32-bit ROM bug. If the 32nd bit of any of the ROM contents is set, that value will be a negative number. My control ROM never sets that bit, so I don't need to deal with that bug here. My tests show that in the case of ROM contents, negative values are not a problem, at least with the Verilog compilers I use. I fixed the 32-bit counter max val bug by making the counter 31 bits. I had to use splitters to convert between 32 and 31 bits. I fixed the 2-input priority encoder bug by making the encoder 4-input with the 2 new inputs 0. Now all my encoders are 4-input. And I fixed my unconnected line bug by connecting it to 0. Evolution will tell you if it can convert a given component to VHDL and Verilog. Note the green for convertible and red for not convertible. To use Evolution's conversion process, you should remove anything not convertible. As with VHDL, for Verilog, I had to remove the divider. Now for just Verilog, I have to remove the multiplier. This is what I'll run through the FPGA Commander. You can choose the board you have. If yours is not listed, you can try to add it yourself. I'll use FPGA4U just for the heck of it. Clicking Annotate will add labels to any unlabeled components and subcircuits. Everything has to be called something. Download creates the code. Now the unmapped buttons and LEDs need to be mapped to the desired components on your board. Your options are highlighted in red. Select which one you want to assign. Look at any errors or warnings that pop up. I don't know how to deal with the gated clock warnings, so that could be a problem I would have to tackle in the actual FPGA implementation. Also, you can click on the red arrow icons to go right to the offending parts. It's not really practical to teach all of Verilog in this video, so I'll just cover some basics and things to look out for when using Evolution's generated Verilog code. Except for the use of begin and end and some keywords, Verilog is similar to C. Wire, reg, integer, and a few other data types all do similar things, but there are rules about which can be used where. Generally speaking, use wire to connect things, and reg to store data in an always or initial block and in procedures. Wires can only be used for combinational logic. Regs can be used for either combinational or sequential logic. There are also blocking assignments, which are denoted by just an equals, and non-blocking assignments, which are denoted by a less than equals. With a non-blocking assignment, the assignment takes place once the always block has finished. With a blocking assignment, the assignment takes place immediately. Processes can be declared with initial or always. The initial block is a special case of an always block. An initial block only runs once. Every always and initial block runs concurrently, meaning in parallel. and always performs the operations in the block once the conditions in the sensitivity list are met. Statements inside procedures and functions run sequentially. Unfortunately, Evolution does have some bugs specific to Verilog. For one thing, the counter doesn't seem to work if it's a rising edge counter. I don't fully understand Evolution's generated counter code, but I found commenting out the conditional in the positive edge clock trigger section solves the problem. I don't know what bad effects, if any, this might cause. The next bug is with the subtractor code. Evolution does the subtraction in a weird way. I believe they forgot to factor in 2's complement. Each negation needs to add 1 after negating, so I could just add 2 in order to get the correct result, but I think I'll just do it the normal way instead, using a minus. Now to add in what I had to take out to make the conversion process work. Rather than edit it now in this video, I'll describe what had to be done. I had to add the multiplier and divider components to the ALU. Then I added 3 new signal lines for the output of the multiplier and divider. To go to the MUX, input line numbers 2, 3, and 8. The values were 0 before. Then I created the multiplier file, guessing at what it should be. Then I created the divider file. I had to guess how to implement a divider, and I only implemented what my CPU design needed. Other CPU designs might need to more fully implement a divider. I also had to handle division by zero. I chose to do the same thing Evolution does in that case, setting the result to be the same as the dividend and the remainder to be zero. Since I'm not testing this on an actual FPGA for you board, I don't need the top level and base Verilog code that Evolution creates. And I don't really need the CPU zero code since that is somewhat redundant. But I do need to write a test bench to call the CPU component. There are no parameters in this file since this will be the top level. I declare the wires needed. I declare the regs needed. I create an initial process that runs the test. It creates the VCD output file, resets and starts the CPU, and runs the clock. The pound sign specifies delays. If the opcode is the data in instruction I want to read from the keyboard, and if the CPU is ever in the halted state, I want to end the simulation early. And finally, I instantiate the CPU and program components, pairing the parameters with the wires and regs. Now the program and memory code. This time there are module parameters. I declare the type and size of the parameters. I create the memory bank holding the program and RAM. I split the address into separate wire pieces to reduce what has to be typed. I create an initial process to read the program from the file prog.raw and then end. Then I create an always block that gets triggered on the falling edge of the write enable line. This block is for the writes to the devices. It just outputs to the screen what would go to the devices. Then I create an always block that also gets triggered on the falling edge of the write enable line. This block writes to the RAM. I could have combined these 2 blocks. Unlike VHDL, Verilog does let me modify the contents of the memory bank where the program resides, so I don't need 2 separate banks. I set the output of the memory. I chose to use the free Icarus Verilog program to compile the code. If you have an FPGA board, most likely you'll have a VHDL and Verilog IDE and compiler specific to that board. You would probably want to use that. Here's the batch file I created to compile it. Now I'll compile it. To run it, you use Icarus Verilog's VVP program. Ignore the warning messages. They just say the program isn't the same exact size as the memory. With my Verilog test bench implementation, I don't have to type the desired options twice like I had to with VHDL. You can see what would be sent to the devices. Now I'll use the free GTKWave program to display the waveform traces of any lines I desire. Here's the batch file I wrote to run it. You can select which lines you want to see. I'll now zoom out to see more of the range and look through all of the values as it ran the program. Well, it's great that it worked. From what I read, getting a design to be ready to be put in an FPGA involves a little more work. You have to deal with whatever gate delay timing issues or other timing constraints that might arise, as well as any peculiarities of the particular FPGA board and other design issues. You might need to use the specific software that came with your board to work those out. By the way, both Xilinx and Altera have free scaled-down versions of their software if you want to give those a try. I'll be showing Altera's software later in this video. Now I'll show a different version of Logisim Evolution. This one is done by Kevin Walsh, who is the author of the Cornell components I've mentioned in other videos. One nice feature of his version is the easy ability to switch between original Logisim's memory component's appearance and Evolution's appearance. You can see how useful this would be. Another nice feature is the fully automated process of synthesizing and downloading to an FPGA board using either Altera or Xilinx programs. To make things easier, I put the program that the CPU will run in a ROM. If you use RAM, make sure you wire up the right enable line, otherwise your CPU will probably be optimized out. This is because if it realizes a particular path isn't used or is always constant, etc., it will optimize it out. By the way, I used the smallest size ROM that my program would fit in to make it optimize faster. It will take longer to optimize and synthesize a ROM than a RAM. Since I only downloaded the Cyclone 4 device library, I'll choose the Terasic DE0 Nano board. The first time you use this process in a given session, you need to put in the location of your Altera or Xilinx program. The optimization and synthesization processes can take quite a while. If your circuit uses a clock, but you get a warning about no clocks in the design, that's a pretty good indication your design has been optimized out. Since I don't currently have a DE0 Nano board connected, it will give an error in the downloading process. There is a problem with the automated process, though. If there are any Evolution VHDL or Verilog generation bugs, and we know there are, there's no way to change the generated code before it goes through to the optimization and synthesization process. Same thing applies if you needed to manually put in what Evolution couldn't convert, such as a multiplier and a divider. If you are using VHDL as the intermediate language between Evolution and the synthesizer, which, by the way, Kevin Walsh recommends, since the VHDL conversion code has been worked on more, you can use a feature of Evolution to add a VHDL component to your design. The other Evolution distribution has this feature as well, but you might have to enable it by going to the Project menu, then Load Library, selecting Built-in Library, and choosing HDL IP. If the VHDL validate button isn't selectable, your VHDL code passed some basic validation tests. I believe you have to have both the entity and architecture sections in the same file. Once you've created the VHDL component, it can be wired up just like any other component. However, it won't simulate like normal in Logisim. Maybe if you have Questa, it will, I don't know. But it will be used when your design's VHDL code is generated. You could also load the Evolution created files into your board software before or after you edit the generated VHDL or Verilog code as needed. Look in the sandbox directory for the project file, which is a QPF file in the case of Altera By the way, the QSF file contains some useful information. Now I'll show Altera's Cortis software. This is the free version. It's a lot more complicated than GHDL, Icarus Verilog, and GTKWave, but those can't create a bitstream to send to an FPGA board. Now I'll show Notepad++, which I've used in this video to do the editing. As you can see, it highlights various programming constructs in different colors. You can also click the minus and plus buttons to hide or show any particular block of the code. Another feature is predicting what you might be typing: keywords, procedure names, variables, whatever. You can select from the list. Also, once an indented block has been started, it will automatically indent the next line. In case you're wondering how it knows how to do all this, it has settings for many different languages, including VHDL and Verilog. If you've used various programming IDEs, these capabilities will be familiar. And if you don't like the color theme, you can choose many others. By the way, I changed the settings of the theme used in this video by choosing a bigger font to make it a little easier for people viewing this video on a cell phone. At any rate, I'm very adept with VI, so I guess I'll keep using VI. But I can definitely see how useful Notepad++ is. Well, I've potentially given you a lot to explore. I hope I've given you all the information you'll need to design whatever you want. Happy exploring.